In this video, I go over two IP addresses in Azure that you should know about. Hello everyone, this is Seraltos and I'm Travis. In this video, I'm going to go over two IP addresses that are unique in Azure, the WireServer address and the Azure Instance Metadata Service IP. Before we get started, please subscribe, like, and click the bell icon for updates of new content. If you subscribed, thank you. Let's get started with what's referred to as the WireServer IP. The IP address is 168.63.129.16 and enables communication between an Azure VM and the Azure Service Fabric. The first thing you may notice is that this is a public IP. It is, but it's not accessible outside of Azure. Microsoft needed a way to enable communications between the Azure Service Fabric and VMs, but they couldn't use a non-routable 10. or 192.168 or 172.16 address space because that could overlap with customers' own address space. Instead, Microsoft dedicated this public IP as a special address that will not change. All communication between the WireServer IP and the client is secure, staying on the Azure network. The WireServer IP is used for communication between Azure and the VM agent. The client requires outbound communication to this IP address over port 80.443 and 32526. Network security groups will not impact this traffic, but a client firewall will. So if you enable a firewall on a client, make sure that traffic to this IP is open. Matter of fact, that gets to why you need to know about this IP. It's a publicly routable IP, so it may be tempting to block traffic to and from it on the client. Don't. This IP needs to be available to the Azure VM for the agent to function properly. And although all clients use the same IP, traffic is isolated between the one instance of the WireServer IP and the client. The WireServer IP also offers filtered DNS services. It filters the DNS requests to only the host names in your subscription. Matter of fact, we can take a look at how it handles things like private endpoints with NS lookup. Let's take a look at that now. In this quick lab, I'm going to show you how the WireServer IP can be used to resolve DNS requests specific to your domain. I have a couple private endpoints for Azure files. One of them is in my internal DNS and the other isn't. We can see this by running NS lookup against the two private endpoints. Let's start by going into NS lookup. And you can see the address is set to my private DNS server. I'm going to enter in the first host name. This one is in DNS. And it found it and gave me back an IP address. Let's enter in the second one. And remember, this one is not in my DNS. Here it's telling us it can't find that host. I got a response from the first, but not the second. That's because the first host name is in my internal DNS server. If you want to see more about how I set these up, take a look at my video on private endpoints and SMB file shares. Here's the DNS server, and you can see privatelink.file.core.net only has one host name in it for the CIR file test 01. Here we are back at the client. What I'm going to do next is change the DNS server to the WireServer IP address. I'll do that by typing in server and then the IP address. Now all DNS queries will go to that IP address. I'll enter in that first host name again. There's the response just like before. Now if I enter in that second one, we got the private IP back for that as well. Using the WireServer IP address to resolve host names in Azure will give me back those private IP addresses even if I don't have them in my internal DNS server. In theory, you could set up a conditional forwarder to send all privatelink.file.core.windows.net queries to the WireServer IP, but remember, only Azure VMs have access to that IP. Hosts outside of Azure would not be able to resolve the host name in that domain because they don't have access to the WireServer IP. Cool. Some other important things it does. If the service is behind a load balancer, the health probe comes from the WireServer IP. Be sure not to block inbound traffic from that IP address. Also, it's the DHCP server for the Azure VM. It's also used for VM agent heartbeat messages. For all these reasons, it's important to allow communication between the WireServer IP and the Azure VM. Let's move on to the next IP, the Azure Instance Metadata Service. The Azure Instance Metadata Service IP address is 169.254.169.254. It's used to retrieve metadata about a VM and the Azure services. It can be helpful if you want to run an automation job and pull details about the Azure environment from inside the VM, or if you need to pull information for support. Like the WireServer IP address, it's not available from outside the VM. But instead of using a dedicated public IP like WireServer, the Azure Instance Metadata Service, or IMDS, as I'll call it going forward, is a private non-routable 169 IP. The IMDS is a REST endpoint available only from inside the VM. In addition to using it to collect metadata, it can also be useful to identify scheduled maintenance events. For example, if Microsoft predicts a host failure and needs to move services, there may be a scheduled maintenance event indicated. I say there may be because the amount of time is dependent on the actual risk of the predicted outage. But if some type of maintenance is scheduled, this is where you'd identify it. Identifying scheduled maintenance is useful because you could redeploy the VM on your own schedule and prevent an unplanned outage. The best way to understand is to see it in action. Let's take a look now. Let's start this demo by taking a look at the data we can view from the IMDS endpoint. We'll start with an overview. First, I'm going to use the invoke REST method to get the information and assign it to the metadata variable. Now, if I view the metadata variable, we've got it, but it's not really formatted well. We can view it as JSON, which is formatted a little easier to read by piping the data into the convert to JSON command. Okay, so that's better, but not perfect. But this is a REST endpoint. We can use Postman to create and view the API calls. I just published a video on using Postman and REST APIs with PowerShell. You can take a look at that if you're interested, but I'm going to grab this URL. And also notice the metadata equals true in the header. So now I'm going to go into Postman. I'm going to paste that URL in. So there, the only key value pair it has is the API version. I'm going to go to headers and add the metadata and true. Okay, now let's send that. Let's see what we get back. Here it is. Here is the output from that REST API call. We can view things like the location, the name, all sorts of information is available from this REST endpoint. I'm going to go back to code next. And I have an example here of if we just want to retrieve the OS. Here I formatted the URL for the metadata instant compute and SKU. So we're drilling down into the specific SKU. And if I run this, here it's displaying 2019 data center. So now I have the SKU information. Another piece of useful information we can get is any events that are going on that may interrupt services on this VM. So if I scroll down, here I have a URL that's getting all the scheduled events. So the first thing I'm going to do is clear this out. And then I'll run this. And it shows no scheduled events. Let's create one. I'm going to go into the portal and I'm going to restart this VM. And if I just keep running this, within a minute or two, it should show a scheduled event of a restart. There it is. So now we can see we have a restart event. And eventually, this machine is going to shut down and I won't be able to access it. But before that happens, I'm going to run that same query in Postman. I'll create a new project. Enter the URL. And then go to the headers. And we have to add that metadata equals true. Now we get a nicer format of that. That is how you query the IMDS REST endpoint to get information about the environment and schedule events. There you have it. The WireServer IP is for VM agent communication, DNS and load balancing communication, while the IMDS is to gather metadata about your VM instance, including scheduled events. I hope you found this helpful. If so, please subscribe, like, and all that good stuff. Thanks for watching.